It's okay. I thought it was Monday, so. All right. So who's been to one of our leadership workshops so far? Quinn and Chelsea. Okay. Calvin. Yeah. So the other workshops that we've done. Our other like leadership workshops that we've done for this series.
I've been to the conference last year.
The like student leadership conference?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So this video is going to be the last of the 5 levels of leadership. So we've already gone through the first 4. So I'm just going to kind of review what those were so you guys aren't lost. And then I'll play the video. And we have our lovely panelists sitting behind you guys. And they're going to come up and they're going to kind of give their experience with the 5th level of leadership. And then you guys will have a chance to ask them any questions that you guys come up with. And hopefully they'll be able to answer them for you. And since it's such a small group, we'll be able to have some discussion. The first level leadership that we went over was the position level. So that is the rights level. So people follow you because they have to. So you're given a position, a managerial position, or a supervisor position. And so people listen and do what you tell them to because otherwise they'll get fired. The second level is the permission level. So the keyword for that one is relationships. And that is people follow you because they want to. So you've developed some sort of relationship with the people who you are supervising, whom you're managing, and they've come to like you, and they've come to kind of see you as a cool person, and so they follow you because they want to. The production level is the 3rd level, and so that one is based off of results, and so it's what you've done for the organization. So if you've been a part of ASU for a really long time and you're in a high level at ASU, people may not know you, but they know that you started a TRIO program on the West Campus or you've done something else, and so people respect you without knowing you and they'll follow you and have that sort of relationship with you simply because they know what you've done for the organization and they know kind of your history and your background. And the 4th level that we've come up, John C. Maxwell talks about, is the people development level. So that is the reproduction level. So people follow you because of what you've done for them. So that's, you've developed a really good relationship with the people that are following you. And so you've started to develop them in other ways. So whether that's personally, spiritually, professionally, you've started to work on those different developments, and that person now respects you because you've helped them grow, and you are in the process of teaching them how to be a leader, and then how to teach others how to be a leader and to keep that process going. So I'm going to turn off the lights, and we'll play the 5th level.
Now there's one more level. That's level number 5. The pinnacle level. The pinnacle level, the key word there, is respect. You've done it so well with so many for so long. The people just absolutely follow you. They follow you because of who you are, the qualities you have in your life. They follow you because of what you have done. And there's a great amount of respect. And it takes a long time to get to level number 5. Most of us aren't there. All of us would probably like to be there, but it's a lifelong journey. And what I want you to understand about the 5 levels is that's exactly what leadership is. Leadership is an always ongoing, always learning, growing process. Okay. Let me ask you a question. You've got the 5 levels there. You can see them, and you can see how each one kind of leads into the next one. And probably the question you've asked yourself now by this time, because you're a sharp crowd, you've asked yourself, wonder what level I'm on. Am I on level 1 or am I on level 3? Am I on level 4? You've already done that, and I know you have. That's what I would be doing if I'd be sitting there and be saying, okay, where were you, Maxwell? And if you ask that question and you kind of go deep in that question, you're going to get a little frustrated because you know what you're going to discover? You're going to discover that you're not on the same level with everybody. there was somebody, you're maybe on level two, with somebody else, you may be on level four. Isn't that true? If somebody new came in the company, you're on level one with them. And what you're going to discover is that you're on different levels with different people. Now, I wish I had an hour to teach this whole process, but here's what I want you to understand. Here's your assignment, very simple. Take the people that you lead, put their names down, and ask yourself a simple question. What level am I on with that person? Do your best to kind of put a number there, and I know it can kind of bleed together, so it's not quite the exact science, but do your best shot. Because after you know what level you're on with each one of your people, then you're going to know specifically how to lead them. Now here's the key. Whenever you try to cast vision with people in your organization, in your department, they don't see you based upon who you are as a person or as a leader. They see you through the five levels grid. And a person on level one, when you talk about a vision, a person on level one sees you entirely different than a person on level number four. The commitment level is much higher the higher you go with your people. So therefore, when you cast a vision or when you lay it out for your people and say, this is where we want to go, just understand, it may be the same company, maybe the same building, maybe the same time, it may be the same speech, but the reactions are going to be different, and the reactions are going to be different because they're on different levels with you. So take the notes, study them, apply them to your life, begin to be a student of the five levels of leadership, and I wish you well, because leadership is influence, always has been, always will be. And within you, you have the power to increase that influence. God bless. Thank you very much. Have a great day.
He said that it's going to be a process, and so, but if you keep working at it and you keep the focus on yourself and the relationship that you have with the people that are following you, and you're not worried about other people and the kinds of relationships that they're having with others, then you're going to be successful and you're going to be able to reach that pinnacle level. So it's a great summary. I would love to bring up our panelists for today. Introduce yourselves and kind of what you do within ASU and any other outside activities that you guys may do that kind of can contribute to the conversation. And then we'll ask about your guys' experience with the pinnacle level, and then we'll open up the crowd for questions. Yeah. Whoever wants to start.
Hello everyone, my name is Taylor Hannah. I work at Taylor Place, the residence hall in downtown's campus, is one of the community directors. There are two of us right now. We're live-in full-time staff members who help support students and make sure that we're there as a resource for them 24/7.
I'm Quinn Liu, and I am the SSS coordinator for the downtown TRIO program.
My name is Maria Alvarez, and I am the SSS coordinator. For 10 years now, and I've been doing all kinds of work. I started as an undergrad, and then did student jobs. I worked at WP Carey, and now I'm excited to be supporting TRIO in this role.
how to follow up with Maria's stuff here. I've also been with the OTU going on 9 years, and started out in terms of students, because I started out with facilities management, so it was not servicing students at all, but then transitioned over to financial aid to admissions services, international admissions, and then moved over to here.
So I'm like these two wonderful ladies. I moved here to Phoenix about 7 months ago after I got my master's. I did all 6 of my years of education at the University of Kansas. It's a very different thing. Phoenix, but I have spent my entire higher education and student support career in residence life and housing and doing things within the residence halls of students.
So what experiences can you ladies kind of talk about that you've had with whether it's someone who you believe to be on that fifth level of leadership or someone who you could see rising to that fifth level of leadership?
I would say, first off, when you said the fifth level, and you said respect, right? And then the person that has gained respect and has, you know, kind of gotten the crowd to move on with them. The first person that came to my mind is my current director right now, because it is he, the reason why I transitioned over to the TRIO program. What I was doing before as a international admissions specialist, essentially a recruiter, traveling outside of the U.S. and recruiting students to ASU. And for me, that honestly, that was probably my dream job. But I also feel, and I do believe, that if you don't have room to grow as much as you love it, and you're staying stagnant, and if you feel like you can do that job with your eyes closed, then it is time for you to progress on and keep on moving. And I think about Ralph, that, you know, things, we parted ways in a positive way, and then now we're regrouping. But the reason why I decided to come back and work for him was the key word, respect. You know, he was always very supportive in whatever I wanted to do, and was never a micromanaging manager at the time, and even so now as a director. And I think in part now, we spent years together, so he knows how I function, but I think there's a gap too of 5 years of being apart, and now we're regrouping and getting to know each other, trying to understand how each other function. I just have the utmost respect for him, just knowing that he will always have my back. Even if, yeah, maybe I made a mistake, you know, but he's always gonna somewhat shield that for me, you know, and always, no matter what, in a professional environment or my personal environment, I know that he's always going to be there to help me. And so when we're going through the whole 5 levels, I really feel like he's got all that, from my point of view, to lead me, want to, you know, follow him to this point.
I love that.
And
I can see that. Like, I haven't been here long, but like I know Ralph, and I know like that influence, kind of like you said, that leadership influence, how he has over everyone, and everyone just adores him.
Yeah.
And it's real. It's like that walking example.
Yeah. And I feel like he's a teddy bear. You know, that, and we get along very well, where, you know, he kind of knows how I tick, I know how he ticks, and we just kind of feed off. Just really, I feel as a leader, you really gotta understand your people. And I really stick with the policy of, you know, treating others the way that you want to be treated. Lead by example. And so, you know, that's always been my motto. And I think with him, he's got that. You know, it's just leading by example as much as he can, and then treating others always with the utmost respect, the way that he wants to be treated. So that's why it makes my life easy, showing up, because we have been there where we've worked for bosses that are not so great, maybe don't have any of the levels of leadership, and you have to kind of bite your tongue and do what you gotta do, and eventually move on. So.
Yeah,
I would say the same thing about the mentor that I was talking about earlier, Alberto Rios. He taught me to not apologize, especially as a woman of color. He was like very adamant about not apologizing for the work that I was doing, not apologizing for being less confident in my essays or whatever it was that I was working on. Because he was like, essentially, you're marketing yourself. You are the product here. And so you want to make sure that you are extending yourself to, you know, your highest potential, because ultimately that the product that you're selling is you. And so I learned that a lot about from him. And he also really taught me to ask questions and to not be afraid to accept when I didn't know something and look at it as a growing or as a learning opportunity. And in the years that I worked with him, the 3 years that I worked with him, I went to every single one of his classes. And I learned about topics that I had an interest in, but I didn't really know much about, like magical realism. He taught a class on deep revision, on how to revise your work, how to look at it, interrogate it from a very different angle than you normally would. And in those classes, I learned to approach things from very unconventional angles. And I'm talking mostly about creative writing, but you can apply these to really any field that you're working in. The idea of not apologizing for the work that you're doing, but being confident and resilient, because nobody else is going to believe you unless you sell yourself in a certain way. And so I learned that from him. And what I really like about him as well is that he speaks to everyone, whether you're an undergraduate or somebody, a member from the community or a colleague, the same way. There is no hierarchy. He is not going to give the attention to the colleague, that would be different from someone in the community. Everybody gets that equal attention because he has that level of respect for everyone. And I've observed him and I've looked at that and I'm like, wow, like he's really popular in the community and people love him and he gets awards. And I'm always wondering, like, how does he do it? Like, how does he juggle all that stuff? And I've observed him and I've noticed that it's because he's able to navigate the people spheres. He's able to, like in one of the, during the leadership video, he talked about how to talk to people and how to navigate in social circles. And I think about that because essentially, no matter what you're doing, even if you're doing tech or if you're doing something like, you know, engaging with students, you're going to be talking with people on a daily basis. And so you need to learn how to listen, how to be considerate, and also when to speak up.
So I also was thinking of a human when reading through everything and watching the video to prepare for this. Ironically, I was given the book, The Five Levels of Leadership, about 7 years ago now when I was a freshman in college, by my mentor. He was an assistant director in housing and one of the advisors for some of the residence hall organizations that I was a part of. And he gave it to me after the conference to help me kind of figure out like my path and how to kind of drive my own leadership style, which now looking back, that's such a leader thing to do, to give someone else and to pass on that knowledge, which I believe is part of level 3, where you're passing on the knowledge. And so this mentor, he passed away about 2 years ago now, and he was with me my entire undergraduate career. And I think of him as kind of that level 5 leadership at the pinnacle because of his personality and the way that people would gravitate towards him, because he made everyone feel important. I remember going into his office for a various, at the time, life crises, because we know our students always have things going on and things are at different levels of importance to them. To you, that may not be that big of a deal, but he always made me feel that, like, whenever I was going in there, I was important, whatever I had going on was important, and that he was there to listen and to do what he could to help. And we had a very strong relationship through our advising styles as well. So it was that trust and that respect. Because one thing I was thinking of when he was talking about respect was, it's not just the respect the leader gives to the followers, it's the respect, conversely, that the followers give back. So it's a very mutual, it's a mutual process. So when thinking of that pinnacle, it's not something that my mentor would have ever assigned to himself. It's something that I think other people give you and that you earn over time. I'd be shocked if I ever met a pinnacle who was like, I'm definitely a pinnacle. That's me. Because I don't see any of our humans really thinking of themselves that way. It's something that others give to you and that you earn, and it takes a long time to do. And kind of like what Maxwell was talking about, like we all want to be there, but it takes time. It takes a long time.
Yeah. So the key word for this level of leadership is respect. And so my other question that I have for you guys is, what does respect mean to you?
The first thing that comes to my mind, and I think that Nina hears this a lot, the first thing, just that respect, and even when hearing the video, is just the whole, you know, treating others the way they want to be treated. It's just such a simple motto, but very hard to do. I feel like when just seeing other people, observing other people, I feel like sometimes that's so hard for them when, you know, and I always try to see things from the perspective, okay? Like, especially when we all run into a situation, right? And it's like the miscommunication or whatnot, or somebody's feelings are getting hurt, a disagreement, arguments, whatever it is. And I, over the years, as I'm getting older, I'm always trying to reflect, like, okay, you know, how did I come across? You know, could I have done better to, you know, show respect to that person? But ultimately, I just really feel like the respect stems from, you know, treating people the way that you want to be treated, you know, with dignity and not embarrassing them. You know, I don't like to embarrass anybody out in public, because I sure as hell don't want that to happen to me. So that's pretty much how I view the whole respect.
You said something that that I thought was really interesting about reflection and how important self-reflection is, especially when it comes to having that mutual consideration. Because if you are not asking yourself questions, if you are not interrogating yourself, okay, so what could I have learned from that experience? Or did I sound rude in that moment? I should maybe look into that or evaluate. If you're not willing to do that, then you're essentially not willing to grow. And because of that, you are definitely, that mutual consideration is not there. That respect that you want to receive is not being conveyed. And so I think that a huge part of that respect is making sure that you are also constantly doing like a self-check, reflecting on conversations, moments, being very aware how you comport yourself in a professional space, in any kind of social setting, really, and knowing when to... Earlier I said, don't apologize for your work. There's a caveat to that. You should also be aware of when to own a mistake or when to own something that you feel you could have done, you know, better on, you could have improved on. If there was something that you feel does not reflect your best intentions or your best work, then you should, you know, speak to that and maybe approach the person if you feel like you maybe offended them. You know, I was thinking about it, and I came across this way. That wasn't my intention, but I wanted to let you know that I was thinking about it. And I think that also kind of feeds into the respect and how you can build mutual consideration.
Because I think what you and I are approaching of the reflection mm-hmm. part, I think that's a big piece of becoming a good leader too, is that you can really, so there's a difference of getting like put down and like criticized, and then there's the other part where it's constructive criticism that you're getting, and you're actually, you're taking it in, you're thinking about it, and you're sleeping on it, and it might, you know, irk you in whatever way, but you're truly reflecting on it and really seeing like, okay, what could have I done? You know, maybe I said this, you know, she took it differently or he took it differently. And why is that, you know? That makes you improve as a leader rather than just like, okay, whatever. Thanks, Maria, that's your opinion.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna stick with, you know, whatever I believe. I really don't care for that approach, and I think for me, over the years, again, because I'm sure if I compare my 18, 21-year-old me until now, it's like it's a huge difference where you're learning, you're progressing, and realizing like, hey, it's okay to apologize, because that's another thing that I always kind of follow, that, you know, especially if you're working in a team environment, or you're overseeing a group of students or your team, you know, that you should just, if you feel like you're in the wrong or you feel like they might think that you're in the wrong, at times I just feel like, hey, maybe I wasn't, but if it's going to make it better for the whole team, because honestly sometimes people just want that apology to kind of kickstart the conversation. It's all it is. It's just like, hey, you know what? I'm really sorry that, you know, I was rude to you, Leo, or Kevin. I'm sorry that I was on a bad attitude and just kind of took it out on you and didn't mean it, or, you know, or even just saying, hey, my day, did it come across a little bit rude probably? You know, I think it really helps when you approach it like that.
One of the things I was thinking of when you were talking about kind of the intent versus impact piece, where you may have intended it one way and someone took it another. Like, one of the best things that I think I was ever taught through my mentors was, is that I don't get to tell other people how I made them feel. They tell me how I made them feel, and I can either grow and learn from that and continue to show that respect that I have for them, or I could choose to ignore it and therefore not show that respect that they deserve. But I think the real pinnacle of being a respectful leader is seeing that it goes both ways.
Mm-hmm.
If you have someone who says something to you and you're just not quite sure what's going on, like talking to them and having that mutual respect of communication and figuring out how to best move forward. Because the other thing I was definitely thinking of was, have you all ever heard that phrase, like, everyone's trying their best?
Mm-hmm.
At any given time, like, everyone is trying their best, and just trying to keep that in the back of your mind. If someone maybe isn't showing you the respect that you think you deserve, just knowing that you don't always know what's going on in everyone's head and what they may be going through, so showing them the respect of following up and doing the best that you can to support them. It's a lot of mutual support and communication and understanding, and that takes a long time to get to, which is why Pinnacle is not something that I think everyone gets to, whatever.
Yeah. So, audience members, what questions do you guys have for our panelists?
You guys brought up age. Do you think age is something as a big piece in reaching Pinnacle? Like, can people get to the Pinnacle before a certain age? Is there a certain age that you find in your life? Being respected, or can you get there anytime?
I don't know, I kind of feel like you could get there anytime.
I agree. Yeah.
I don't feel like, you know, by 25, you know, if you don't get there, it's over, you know. I think in life, everybody's lifestyle is always going to be different. Different paths that we take, you know. I know for me, I just finished up my master's degree, and then what, 2 months later, a couple weeks, I walked, and then I turned 40, you know. And I have a feeling Taylor here is probably a couple decades, you kidding me?
Absolutely not. So everybody, it goes their own pace, you know. And also, a piece of that is like, what's your measure of success, right? If you're like right out the gate from college and you're like, my goal is to get to this leadership by this amount of years, how about it? Some people are just like, you know what? I want to get a feel because I'm not sure what I want to do after college. And, you know, and maybe they've sat in the same job for like 10 years and realize this is not my cup of tea, switch gears, and they just flourish. And then, you know, it's just gone up the chain. So I really don't think that there's an age factor to it.
So it's more like experience?
That's exactly what I was thinking. It's like, what experiences help you?
Yeah.
Because you have different experiences than I do, absolutely. And I have different experiences than these two. And some people, and kind of like what you're saying, some people see people on different levels. Mm-hmm. So you could be a pinnacle of someone right now, mm-hmm. as a student. And then there may be people who don't see me as a pinnacle because they don't know me yet. Yeah.
Let's just put it this way. I've met some really mature young people, mm-hmm. and some really juvenile adults. So with that being said, if you feel in yourself, I want to get to that level, then like Lynn said, please go for it. Mm-hmm. Especially if you're already making those conscious efforts right now, if you're asking those questions, how can I be a pinnacle? Is there a certain age? I think that's already heading in the right direction because you are interrogating yourself and you're self-reflecting and you're being present. You're here in this space right now asking those questions. I think that says a lot already.
Definitely.
Yeah. And I think it's just like, then you're tying in your personal life too. Where are you at in your personal life? Because sometimes that somewhat dictates, right, your professional life almost, where you want to go, what you want to do.
It's tricky to separate the two.
Yeah, it is. And balance it too.
Balance the two.
Yes.
So. Please teach me.
I'm still learning. Good question, though. But one thing, following up with that, I just realized too, like, don't feel that age is a factor to a lot of things in life, you know? People just, naturally, I feel like we all naturally do that, like, oh, I'm too old for this, I'm too old for that. I know I found myself doing that, too, when I was thinking of going back to get my master's degree. This, you know, what's the point? That's more like the negative of it. But really, if you want it, go for it. It doesn't hurt, you know. The worst off would be, you know, you compare, like, what's the worst off situation? All right.